Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit. Bandwidth for the Tech Guy is provided by CacheFly. CacheFly.com. Hi, this is Leo Laporte, and this is my Tech Guy podcast. This show originally aired on the Premier Radio Networks on Sunday, January 12th, 2014. This is episode 1048. Enjoy. The Tech Guy podcast is brought to you by Ring Central. I love my cloud-based phone system from Ring Central. Zero startup costs, and Ring Central is as low as $20 per month per user. Try it now with a 30-day risk-free trial, and when you buy one desk phone, you'll get a second phone free up to 20 phones. Call 800-543-9980 or visit ringcentral.com and use our promo code TWITS. Well, hey, how are you today? Leo Laporte here, the Tech Guy. And it's time for the Tech Guy program, the show where we talk about computers and the internet, cell phones and camcorders, MP3 players, home theater, and all that jazz. 888-ASK-LEO, that's the number. 888. I say it so fast, I know. But 888, that's toll-free number, right? 888-827-5536. That's toll free from anywhere in the U.S. and Canada. You can use Skype out if you're outside the U.S. or Canada, and lots of people do. We get calls from all over the world. You'll be talking to the talented H-Balm, Heather Hammond, our phone ranger, and she'll take your call, prepare you. A little later on, Chris Marquardt, I see him in the chat room. He will join us talking digital photography. Yes, it's a jam-packed day. Jam-packed day. Perhaps you're expecting me to come back on this weekend, the weekend after the Consumer Electronics Show, and talk about all the wonderful gizmos and gadgets that we saw at CES. Nothing. Nothing. I think Kara Swisher had it right. She's formerly a Wall Street Journal writer, All Things D, now has a new site called Recode. She said it's now become a marketing event. This is not where innovation happens. It's where marketing happens. And I think that's right. I think that's right. If you have a really great innovations, the Consumer Electronics Show is just too noisy to make a splash. I mean, unless you have something that's so like a flying car, or a floating TV or something, you're just not going to get the attention. There's too many other things going on. So really, it's there. It's there to... You know, I don't know what it's there for, but don't. So, and of course, inevitably, during this period, people call and I do a lot of interviews and, you know, well, what's the big thing? There's nothing. Just relax. The world has changed a lot because of the internet now. Any company can have its own event. Apple showed the way with this, right? Apple hasn't been at CES in years. You have your own event. And if your company is big enough like Samsung or Apple or, you know, Facebook, Yahoo, or Google, you can have your own event and people pay attention to it. And you get all the attention. So it's just, it doesn't seem that important. It's a party. It's fun, but not that important. So don't worry. Don't worry. You didn't miss anything. Curved TVs, big deal. We talked yesterday on the last show with our home theater guru, Scott Wilkinson. About the new 4K displays, lots of those. This is the new UHD, Ultra HD, that the TV industry wants you to buy. And yes, we're seeing a few people put UHD on the internet. It remains to be seen how good it's going to look if it's streaming in over the internet. Probably not very. And then I guess the other thing was wearables. And this is what happens. Yes. Some company does a demo of a product that may never appear, but everybody goes, ooh, and the big hit. Last year, it was the Happy Fork, the vibrating fork. This year, it was MIMO or MIMO. And it's a cool idea. Intel did it with a company. Can't remember their name. Doesn't matter. You'll never see it in the marketplace. It's a onesie for a baby, a little baby, like in a crib baby, that has a bunch of sensors on the onesie. They look pretty uncomfortable. But see, it's a baby, so what's he going to do? He's going to say, "Hey, can you get this stuff off me? Really, I'm not sleeping well." No. So they put this on the baby, and then you know how warm the baby is. You can tell if the baby's crying or not. You can see what the baby's heart rate is, whether the baby's face up or face down, that kind of thing. And then they have, you know, of course you have to put it on your tablet and watch it on a tablet, but since mom and dad are often in the kitchen drinking cups of coffee while the baby's sleeping, I guess, that's not my memory of it, but anyway, they have a special coffee mug that smiles when the baby is happy, when all sensors record positive readings, and frowns when the baby's unhappy. Now, this is a perfect example of why the technology industry gets mocked. Because this really doesn't do anything that a baby monitor wouldn't do. Or I guess, you know, even nowadays they have baby monitors with cameras. But it's cool. It fits the category, the story that journalists want to tell of wearables. That's what everybody's talking about now, right? Technology you wear, whether it's on a wristwatch or on glasses or on clothing, that the quantified self, it measures your footsteps and your heart rate. That's about it. Maybe your elevation and location. It's just silly. And then somebody in the chat room, and I don't know if this came from, I'll read the headline. I don't know if this came from CES or elsewhere. Researchers develop micro windmills that will recharge your cell phone. There you go. I can't imagine anything better on your wrist than a little windmill. Oh, technology. So this, look, there are shows on the TV and the radio and the internet where people are cheerleaders and they're all excited about this stuff. And then there's me. So just, you know, maybe if you want somebody who's going to go, oh, this is so exciting, windmills on your wrist, then this maybe isn't the show for you. I just like to say, I don't think it's really exciting. I don't think that's really great. But who knows? I get, if you wave your arm around a lot, maybe you could charge your phone. I mean, wristwatches, you know, wind, self-wind. I guess it's kind of like that. 8888 Ask Leah. We'll talk about anything you want to talk about. Whatever's on your mind. It could be something from CES. It could be something not from CES. I could tell you I have the new, if you want to talk about Macintosh, the new Mac Pro, that new beautiful aluminum cylinder. Wow. That is so sweet. I was playing with it again last night. It's quiet. It's so quiet. I attached a USB, one of those external USB drives to, I want to make a backup image. I do what I say. I listen to myself. Of course, you have a new computer. First thing you want to do, once you get all set up, make an image of that perfect drive with everything just so. So I did that. That way, if something bad happens, you can go back to that point, right? And I noticed, I said, what is that sound? And I realized, I was hearing the USB drive spin, a little tiny pocket USB drive spin, doesn't have a fan or anything, because everything else was so quiet. The Mac Pro, which has a giant fan and could theoretically generate quite a bit of heat, I was playing video games last night to see if I could really get it hot, is dead silent. Dead silent. So that's nice. You pay for it, $3,000 to start. That's not with it. That does not include a keyboard. It does not include a mouse. It does not include a monitor. just the cylinder, just the tube. $3,000. You could throw in a, come on, Apple, throw in a mouse and a keyboard. Come on. Something. Some software. What a world, what a world. Here's a story from the gadget priest in our chat room. London's Brent Council, who I guess is a person. I don't know who it is. What is Brent Council? Oh, it's area of London. They have replaced human receptionists with a hologram named Shanice. To save $26,000 a year in salary for a living, breathing human receptionist capable of directing people wherever they need to go, the leaders at London's Brent Council decided they'd rather spend 12,000 pounds, $18,000 for a one-time fee to set up a holographic receptionist that can answer limited questions about services in the building. This sounds like bad science fiction. Brenton area? Okay. 8888 Ask Leo. Let's talk tech. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Shanice. I feel I spent $3,000 on cool black Apple stickers, and the computer was just a little throw, you know, a little gimme. It is not my home theater PC. It's my main computer. Not that I need a main computer. That's why the other thing I realized sitting down at it, yeah, this is nice, but when am I going to ever sit at a desk in an office and use a PC? My Xbox One is my home PC. Thing is fast. I showed you yesterday, didn't I? The drive speeds. 700. This is megabytes per second. Read of almost very close to a gigabyte per second. No, it's not spending money, uniwashed mass. You have to understand this is my job, right? Is to review this stuff and talk about it. So, you know, I buy this stuff. It's not really important whether I need it or not. I have to review it.
Would you... it's kind of a carbonite issue. This guy's having trouble. He has a new computer, importing, address book, etc. They said it'll work if you use Outlook.
Oh, don't use Outlook. No one should ever use Outlook.
Okay, you can help him with a workaround, you think?
Yes, of course.
A reach around.
Hey! Okay, I'll make the lights the Niners colors. That's a good idea.
Oh, yeah. Make it gold.
Now I have to get some gold.
I don't know how to make gold.
I don't know how I do gold. How do I do gold?
We need... Oh, Nathan, can you play... What am I thinking of? Fleetwood Mac, Gold Rush Woman? Wait, that's not a song.
I don't have gold in my repertoire.
Yellow?
Just do red and red. I ain't got gold in my repertoire.
Gold dust, that's right.
She's a gold dust woman.
I'm going to finish this coffee.
Leo Laporte, the tech guy. 88. Ask Leo. 888-827-5536. Heather Hammon, the phone ranger, has been lining up telephone calls for us, HH. Who should I talk to?
I think we want to talk to Jim in Walnut Creek.
Hey, Jim in Walnut Creek. Leo Laporte, the tech guy.
Yeah, hi, Leo. Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for not telling us the score of the 49er game off the air.
What 49er game? Is there a game going on?
Because I'm recording it, and I want to be surprised when I play it back.
What you're saying is for the next 4 hours, I may not mention anything about a football game that may or may not be going on in Carolina right now.
I probably won't wait that long.
It is not easy not to say anything, mind you, but I'll attempt not to.
Thank you.
Yes.
So I am an amateur photographer, emphasis on the amateur, and like a lot of amateurs, actually I think some pros as well, go on vacation, shoot a few hundred pictures in a day, go back to the hotel room.
You are an amateur. A few hundred? Yeah, yeah. Come on. You're not hardly trying.
Yeah, that's a slow day. So go back to the hotel room and review the pictures in the camera on that little LCD display.
Yeah, that's not
and
good.
Delete off the ones that are obviously not pretty good.
Right. Oh, so you're gonna just take a chance and keep using that memory card until it's full.
No, well, not when it's full. I'll usually have three or four or five, but I want to basically prune the photos ahead of time.
Yes.
And because I don't have my computer with me on vacation because my wife forbids it, I'm not loading it into Lightroom.
Honey,
I'm not doing all those things.
You should bring your computer with you. But okay, go ahead.
Okay. So for Christmas, my my wife got me an iPad Mini.
Oh, that's nice.
Thought, oh, great display. Hey, yeah. I could use that for previewing photos.
Yes, you could.
And pruning them.
Yes, you could.
But the only way that I could figure out how to do it, and I went to the Apple store and they said, no, you can't do what you want. I don't want to load it on the machine. I want to keep it on the card and just preview it and delete directly from the card.
Yeah, the Apple doesn't support a file system. They feel that that's too complicated for you mortals.
So I took it back and said, thank you very much. And they gave me my money back. And now I have money to spend on another device. And you're going to tell me what to spend money on.
Well, you could have, before you take it back, but it's too late now, you could have gotten the get the camera connection kit. And what I do, and I think this is actually a very good way to do it, is to use the camera connection kit to get JPEGs, not the full raw images, but the JPEGs off your memory card, and open them in iPhoto, and then you can go through it. There is even a program that will tie to Lightroom that will allow you to pre-select and then feed that out to Lightroom.
Lightroom on your computer?
Yeah, it ties to Lightroom on your computer if you have a Mac. But now that you've brought it back, so let's not tease you with solutions that you're never going to use. So what you are looking for probably is a thing called a photo wallet. Epson makes them. A lot of companies make them. What they do is they're basically a hard drive with a relatively nice LCD screen and a card reader. And you pop the card in the card reader, copies everything off the cards, and now you have a backup, which is something you really want.
Yeah.
And you can review those images. You know, some of these have quite large, not as big as the iPad, but quite large LCD screens that are more, frankly, more accurate than the iPad. And those, then that's what a lot of pros use. I mean, really, the best thing is to bring your computer. And the reason you do want to do that is what you do want to do as soon as you get back from your day of shooting is copy everything off that card, not just to a computer, but to another hard drive. So you have a couple more copies of it, presuming that something in there is special. M5 in our chat room is giving me a link to a number of digital photo wallets, memory card backups, things like that. But from a lot of Chinese companies making these, a few $100, less than an iPad. Let me see if Epson still makes theirs, because I've used the Epson and it was quite good. It's a category that might be dying thanks to the success of the iPad. The Epson, these are pretty old. I don't know. They may not make these anymore. That would be sad. That would be sad to me.
The nice thing about a tablet, I thought, would be not only could I preview photos and prune my photos, but when I'm done with that, I can then read my Kindle books.
Oh, well,
go online and read the newspaper.
So what you're asking is there any tablet that can do what you wanted it to do, which is hook up the camera and view them on the tablet but not copy them to the tablet?
Or plug in an SD card.
Oh, yeah, there are a lot of tablets that'll do that. So certainly all the Windows tablets will do that. I would look at a Samsung Galaxy Note. Let me just check and see which ones have SD card. Is it an SD card?
Yeah.
I think they have SD card readers, which would really be the solution for you. Either the Galaxy Tab or the Galaxy Note.
I love the Retina display.
Yeah, but all the tablets now have equally high quality displays. In fact, Apple's display is not super accurate. So probably not ideal for, I mean, it's fine for what you want to do, which is review them and look at the picture and go, that's not so great. But it's not good enough to say, here's the colors good or whatever. The gamut is not super good. So, yes, you can. The Galaxy Tabs have SD card readers, mostly micro SD, but you could use an adapter for that. You could also hook up using something they call USB to go. You could hook up a USB device that way. I don't know if the Nexus 7, which is a great deal and has a beautiful screen. Let me think if you could do this with a Nexus 7. You might be able to do this with a Nexus 7. I'll have to do some research to see.
Well, they display raw photos rather than just...
Nothing will do raw. So you have to shoot raw plus JPEG to do this.
Okay.
And then you'll load in the JPEGs. But that's fine for what you want to do, which is quick rejection. There's no slots in the Nexus 7, but I think with a proper OTG cable, you could look at the card on the Nexus 7 and review those. I think that would work. I'm gonna have to check. You need USB to go on it, and I would have to check, but I think you can. This is one of those photo wallets. Where'd you get this, Burke? This is the Epson, isn't it? We had this lying around, huh? Do they still make it? That's the question. This is the P7000. This is such a great solution. It's dedicated for photographers. It's about the size of the back of a large camera with a good size screen on it. It has card readers. It has AV out, so you could actually plug it to the TV, do a slideshow. I don't know if they still make this. The P7000. This was
what's the capacity?
Good question. I think they come in a variety of storage sizes. But this is something a little different from what you want. Take a look at the Nexus 7. I'm pretty sure the Nexus 7 will do what you want.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Hey, thanks for the call. Anything to support a photographer. Don't know what the score is. No idea what the score is. 80. What score? What? There's a game? 8888 Ask Leo. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Yeah.
We could just predict the future.
Yeah. I'm kind of not paying attention.
That game several hours ago where we blew out of the water.
Shh. Shh. The iFi cards are terrible. Terrible, terrible. Do not use iFi cards. Horrible. There are, actually, I should have mentioned a number of cameras, like my Sony DX, well, actually all the Sonys now, that have USB. Red and green equals yellow. Okay, let's try it. Red and green.
That's not true.
Looks purple to me. Oh, no, that's blue.
Unless there's something.
Hey! Ooh. Yay!
Is that red?
I knew
and
I'd
green?
Done that before.
Wow.
So you use the Sony app. Actually, this is another good way. I'll mention this when we come back. It's a good way to go. I am doing this show in my sleep. Actually, as a matter of fact.
Who said that?
I am doing this show in my sleep. I hate iFi cards. That's old technology. But many, many cameras, and the problem is I wasn't going to make him buy a new camera, but many, many cameras now are Wi-Fi enabled. Yeah, I told him to get a Windows tablet, but I don't know. I think he wants something lighter and simpler and less, a lot less expensive. Yeah, we got it. That is red and gold, baby. That is Niners colors. That is Niners colors. Gorgeous. I didn't wear any Niners gear at all. I have so much at home. The hard hat, the cap, the throwback cap, the leatherhead cap, the scarf, the throwback jacket, a couple of Super Bowl sweatshirts. They're big sponsors of the NFL. We love Ring Central. They're sponsors of the Brickhouse Studio phone system. It's our cloud-based phone system. When we built the Brickhouse, I did the last thing I wanted to do is put a PBX in the basement. You know me. I don't like dealing with the phone company, with Ma Bell. But with Ring Central, you don't have to. Ring Central is a cloud-based solution that offers so much more than a traditional phone service. I am a huge fan of Ring Central. I mean, I'll give you a list of some of the things we can do with Ring Central. You can use your... They have apps for the smartphones. You can use that to make phone calls. There's no PBX hardware to install or maintain. You customize all your call handling in ways that really only digital can offer. And it's $20 per month per user, which is fantastic. Producers get their, for instance, their calls in their voicemail, in their email. Fax message is right on the smartphone. You get an auto receptionist. If you call our 800 number, which we have through Ring Central, my voice will greet you. It'll give you a directory they can enter an alphabetic directory, announce employees and department extensions. If you're getting calls after hours, Ring Central can route the calls to your smartphone's phone service center or voicemail. I love this. If you're on a Ring Central call and you've got a client on hold, you can type a message into the window and have it translated from text to speech and delivered to the caller. Leo's busy right now, but he'll be with you in just a few seconds. Hang on there, please. things like that. Ring Central, all-inclusive pricing as low as $20 per month per user. We have a 30-day risk-free trial, of course, and a special offer just because you're listening to our podcast. When you buy one desk phone, you'll get a second phone free, up to 20 phones total. Wow, that's a good deal. Call 800-543-9980, 800-543-9980, or you can just go to the website, ringcentral.com, and use the promo code TWIT. Ring Central. All of our phone systems are Ring Central here, and it's just great. Love it. 8888 Ask Leo. So another solution that isn't really probably for our last caller is getting a new camera. A lot of cameras now have Wi-Fi built in. I think now this is almost going to be the standard going forward. And usually what that means is that you run an application. You could run it on a tablet. You could run it on a smartphone. It does work on the iPad. I'm thinking of my Sony RX100-2, and you'll run the Sony app, and you can control the camera from the iPad, but you can also look at pictures on the iPad or a phone and review them and go through them. So next camera, get one with Wi-Fi built in, and that solves the whole problem. That solves the whole problem. Chris in Culver City, Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Hi, Chris.
Hey, Leo. How you doing?
I'm great. How are you?
Pretty well, thank you. Hey, listen, I'm a longtime listener, first time caller, and I had a question for you.
Yeah.
A few years back, I purchased, I'm sure you're familiar with it, one of those little Flow TVs from Qualcomm.
This was the story of the year at CES about 3 years ago, mobile TV.
Yeah. Now, got a question for you.
You bought one, huh?
Actually, I bought one off of a guy off of Craigslist, and he had originally bought the television, and he also bought a 12-month subscription because he wanted to be able to watch a bunch of the World Cup games at his job.
Yeah.
And so when I bought it from him, I bought it from him for like $100, and it included the 10 months left on the subscription, and I'd say it worked out almost perfectly because like 3 weeks before the subscription ran out is when Flow TV said, you know, we're not going to be doing this anymore, and then I filled out a form, and they sent me a check for $200.
Oh, good deal.
Yeah.
Good deal. You did a little arbitrage there.
Yeah.
Very smart.
Well, unintentionally. But what I wanted to find out is I've got this little piece of electronic equipment, and I hate to throw the thing away because it had such a nice screen on it and everything. And I wanted to find out maybe if either you or maybe someone in one of the chat rooms or something would be able to tell me, are there any like hacks or cracks or anything that I could possibly use that thing for aside from a paperweight?
So the idea of this was it was a little TV. And this was, by the way, a huge category. As I said, now I'm thinking more like I would say 2009 CES, mobile TV, baby. Everybody wants a little TV they can carry around with them and watch broadcast television on. No, apparently not. And Qualcomm made Flow TV. I think they acquired it. So the idea was it used some specialized spectrum. I'm trying to remember what it was, but they ended up selling it to AT&T in 2011, I think, that would allow you to watch it on not only on your Flow TV. In fact, you remember they had the ads. A guy had to go shopping, and the big game was on, but he didn't care because he was watching. Anyway, they were going to put it on phones as well. It's a screen. So you should be able to hack it in some way, but it beats me how. Have you opened it up? Have you looked inside?
Not really.
I don't think it's a great screen. The device was about $200, as I remember.
Yeah, I think when it was in the store, it was $249 or something like that. And then if you got the year subscription, it was like an extra $50. I think it was like $299 or something like that. But
Look at this. A chat room to the rescue. And I should have thought of this. There's a great website called Instructables, instructables.com. And they have a forum. And in the forum, they have Flow TV Hacks, question mark. And there's no hacks. Look at that. Well,
okay.
No answers on the if nobody on Instructables has an idea, I think that there is it's probably not something you can do anything.
Okay.
With.
No, the
you made out though. You made out like a bandit, dude.
I did.
Buy.
I sure did.
Buy low, sell high.
Absolutely.
Hey, I'm sorry. Yeah, it's a sad story. In fact, I did a search on Flow TV to see what happened to it, and found an article from 2010, almost exactly 3 years ago. It was December 20th, 2010. Five reasons Flow TV failed. And by the way, Ryan Lawler, who's a great writer and smart guy, got them all wrong. He said it was ahead of its time. No. No. People don't watch live TV on their phones. Yes, that's right. Users needed a dedicated device. Yeah, that's dumb. What they didn't anticipate 3 years ago was things like the Galaxy Note phone and these big screen phones, which are actually better screens, much better screens than the Flow TV screen. And I guess, you know, people do watch TV, I guess, on their phones. You can get the NFL and watch the football game, I guess, on your phone. It seems like it's a stopgap. It's like, it's not something you choose. It's like you're in between places and your wife dragged you shopping or something and you want to watch TV, or your husband, sorry, Heather, dragged you shopping and you want to watch TV, and so you're forced to watch it on the phone. Not like anybody wants to. Then they also Ryan points out that hardware and software were too expensive, and that's true. And frankly, Qualcomm's not a media company. They had no idea what they were doing. That's an interesting question. Would you, if you could watch live... Let's say, you know, you're on the train or, the use case is people who commute but not in a car, right? Would you watch TV? No, people are doing casual gaming. They're doing other stuff. I think this is not a product anybody's looking for. But another great example of how CES so often gets it wrong. This mobile TV was the story at CES in 2009. Maybe 2010. It was the story. Everybody thought, this is the next category. And it just shows you what the way the tech industry works. It's not like they have a crystal ball and they know what everybody wants. They just try stuff until something works. And sometimes it does. Most of the time it doesn't. And it really comes home to you when you go to a place like the Consumer Electronics Show and you look at millions of square foot of junk. And you realize, oh, this is all the stuff that doesn't make it. This is all the stuff that no one wants. Bill in Jacksonville, Florida, you're next. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Hi, Bill.
Hi, Leo. This is Bill. Hey, I've been listening to you for years on the Handle Show, the KFI.
Thank you.
Show.
Yeah, Bill's such a
great guy.
He's such a great guy. He's been so supportive of the tech guy show. Yeah.
Well, that's the most fun hour from 5 to 6 Pacific time listening to the show, and I've always enjoyed the interaction you and Bill have had.
Thanks. Yeah,
but I recently saw a commercial for Dragon voice recognition software.
Yeah,
and I wanted to know something about it.
It's a Mac user. It's the only one, really.
Mm-hmm.
That's the thing. There are others, and certainly if you have a smartphone, Siri on the iPhone and Google Voice on the Android phones does a lot of that. But I presume what you're saying is I want to dictate documents. I want to write with my voice.
Well, yeah. I noticed on the website for the company, there's various versions.
Yeah, we got to take a break, but hang on for a second. I'll talk about the versions, what it does and what it doesn't do. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Yeah, I mean, it's a good point. We do have applications that you can watch Twit on your phone. Nucandescent. We have 100-watt light bulbs. Larry Birnbaum, the man who saved the incandescent light bulb. This is ridiculous. You know why they're legal? Because they only made the 40 and 60s illegal. So hundreds are still legal. Thank you, Larry, for saving the incandescent life bulb. This is his claim to fame. Thomas Edison, the man who invented the incandescent light bulb. Larry Birnbaum, the man who saved the incandescent light bulb. What's wellness? You know, incandescent light bulbs are better for you. I admit, I don't like CFLs. I'm not a CFL fan. I'm going all LED. Larry Birnbaum.
I saw a really cute cartoon where a standard light bulb and an ice cream cone are walking down the street holding hands with the little CFL like it was their baby.
I don't like CFLs.
The light or just the shape, the look?
All of it. They have to warm up. It's just terrible. We have a lot of CFLs in the house because it was built in 2008. Can't wait to replace them. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Idiot, ask Leo. We're talking to Bill in Jacksonville. Was it Bill? Yeah, Bill in Jacksonville, Florida. So you're interested in drag and dictate. So let me tell you a little bit about this. This is a product that hasn't significantly improved in some years, and I don't know why, but it is still the king of speech to text. That's what this does. So it allows you to dictate directly to the computer, and the computer does a decent job of interpreting it. Now, that's the, in my opinion, the sticking point. Decent, not perfect. So let's be generous, say Dragon Dictate is accurate as you speak to it. And by the way, you could speak kind of like I'm speaking, and it'll do a fairly good job. About one word in 10, one word in 15, it gets wrong. Mm-hmm. That's fine, except that you have to stop, correct it, and continue on. And I find it to be a bit of a speed bump. Now, I know people, my friend David Pogue doesn't write his books that way, but writes the indexes to his books that way because he can do it very quickly. So there are some real advantages. I know many people who have carpal tunnel, for instance, their repetitive stress injuries from too much typing, who will use Dragon Dictate, and they're very happy because at least they can continue to create content. So I think it's good. Now, as far as which one you want to get, there is a big difference. You know, it starts at $75, but it can go on up to a lot more. Up to 1,000 if you get the medical version.
Yeah. Obviously, well, in the commercial that there are several people who talk about it. There's a grandmother helping her grandson do homework, but then we get to somebody who says, well, I have to prepare 20 to 30 page reports each day. And that got me to thinking there must be different versions and they probably escalate in price. And I go to the Nuance website and that is indeed the case. So I assume they're not all talking about the introductory $79 version. Is that correct?
That's correct. And now the more expensive ones, like the medical one, have special dictionaries and they just charge more because they can.
Yeah.
The engine is fundamentally the same.
Okay.
So there is Mac Speech as well.
Mm-hmm.
And I would get the Dragon Dictate for the Mac. They were competitors. Nuance has purchased every company in this space.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right. I haven't used Dragon Dictate in a while, but it worked just fine on the Mac. I don't see any reason to get Mac Speech.
I noticed that Dragon Dictate's a lot more expensive than the basic Dragon version for PC. Why is that?
Because they can get away with it, I guess.
Oh, okay.
I don't, you know.
Because the $79 offer does not extend to...
it's Windows only, yeah.
Yeah.
So, okay, it's $200, so what do you want to do with it?
Well, I'm in the process of writing a book on music, and that's what I'm gonna do. Just be able, it seems that I'm always grabbing a legal pad or something like that to write my ideas down. I thought this might be very much more convenient than doing that.
Yeah,
you know,
it is. And have you used Siri dictation or the Google Voice dictation? Any of that stuff?
I have it. No, I'm really slow to grasping the technology.
No, that's fine. I just want to give you something so that you kind of understand what you're gonna get.
Okay.
It's not perfect, I guess, is the point.
Okay. Okay.
But it might be enough for you. I use the voice dictation on Android all the time, even though it isn't perfect,
mm-hmm.
just because it saves me so much time.
Mm-hmm.
It turns out it's very hard to do what they do. It's really hard. We thought this would all be solved years ago.
Yeah.
Speech and handwriting. The human brain is so adept at recognizing at three things that a computer doesn't do very well. Recognizing faces. A two-year-old can tell its mother. A one-year-old can tell its mother from a million other faces like that instantly. Computer,
right.
Most of the time. Same thing with speech. Same thing with handwriting recognition. It's something that we're tuned to do, but the physical hardware of a computer, for instance, and it's interesting that the company that makes this is called Nuance. It's the nuances that are tough. The difference between homonyms, words that sound the same but mean different things depending on context. Computers don't know context. They don't know what you're talking about.
And punctuation also. They wouldn't know a semicolon.
Well, now, here's a good thing. All of these will let you speak the punctuation.
Okay.
So what you'll do with Dragon Dictate is, it was the best of times, comma. It was the worst of times, period. New paragraph.
Right.
And it'll do all of that fairly well.
But you have to tell it to do that, right? Put in the comma. Put it.
Oh, yeah. You don't expect it to punctuate. How would it do that?
That's what I mean. Yeah. It can't read your mind.
You get used to that, though. It's pretty good at that part. Really, the hard part is homonyms, where it's, you know, through, and through. It doesn't know what through the ball or go through the door. I don't understand. Which through are you talking about?
Yeah.
And English is full of these.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very difficult. They've gotten better somewhat. Most of the work, in my opinion, now I've said this before, and somebody from Dragon, one of the speech scientists, immediately sent me an email saying, no, we're working really hard to make this a better product. This is a good product. But I do know that a lot of work is being done at Google in this area.
Mm-hmm.
The Chinese also, because if you think about it, this is a real boon for China because they don't have an alphabet. They have ideographs, and there's hundreds of thousands of them. It's very hard to type in China.
Yeah.
So speech recognition would be a very big boon in China.
I think so, too, yeah.
So they're working hard on it. So I do expect it will get better.
Mm-hmm.
It works best in a constrained vocabulary, so that's why the medical dictate. A lot of, for instance, radiologists, they're reading X-rays. They don't, when they're doing autopsies, their hands are busy. They speak these things, and they do very well because it's a fairly constrained vocabulary. You don't have the same context issues. It already knows the context.
All right. So would you? The bottom line: would you recommend Dragon Dictate or Mac Speech?
Get Dragon Dictate. Get the $200 one.
Okay.
It is the best out there right now. There's nothing anywhere close.
Okay, great. Well, I appreciate your time. Thank you very
pleasure.
Much.
Yeah, and I'm glad to talk about this. I feel like this is an area where we should be doing better, and I'm sure we'll at some point. And you know what's moving it is mobile. Mobile is what's moving it. It's very tricky. Hi, David. Leo Laporte, the tech guy.
Yes, Leo. I went from Windows XP with Thunderbird.
Oh.
Uh-oh.
Oh.
to Windows 8.1 or 8. And Carbonite did a real good job on backing up my document files.
Yeah.
But I'm having a real, real problem of getting my address book and favorites transferred over to the new Carbonite.
Do you use Outlook?
No.
Okay. What are you using for address book and favorites?
Right, address book and favorites.
You said Thunderbird?
Okay, yeah. Well, I had been using Thunderbird, and I started. I wanted it all transferred over to Thunderbird, the newer version, with Windows 8.1. The Carbonite tech said that they don't support importing to any other software program other than Outlook.
No, that's not true. So here's the deal. Outlook's easy because it's and I don't think it's very good. It stores everything in one giant hairball file called outlook.pst.
Yeah.
That makes it easy to back up.
Yeah.
You back up one file. Thunderbird, in my opinion, does it right. Thunderbird uses open standards for how it stores your email, your calendar, and all of that stuff. But it's multiple files. So Carbonite doesn't, frankly, care. All Carbonite or any backup program's job is to get the file saved for you. It's up to you to move it, right? That's not its job because it doesn't know what you're. As long as you're backing up the Thunderbird folders, and that's your profile, you know how you have a profile? As long as you're getting that whole profile folder, you got everything. Then it's nothing Carbonite can do to help you import it. That's that's up to you. Now, since you're using Thunderbird again on Windows 8, I think it should be fairly straightforward. Make sure you get that profile, okay? Leo Laporte, the tech guy. All the personal information is stored in the profile folder. So as long as you back that up, you got it. Right? It may be, oh, I know where it could be a problem. If you install Thunderbird and start using it on the new computer, and now you have the old stuff, that could cause a problem. You have to delete the new profile folder and let it be restored. That's probably the issue. That's probably the issue. You know, if you have a conflicting file of the same name, of course, Carbonite's going to say, well, I don't want to know if I want to overwrite this. I don't know if I want to overwrite this. So it's always best to restore the files before you use the program. Yeah, PSDs are a nightmare. I do not like doing it that way, even though, yes, it's easy to back up. That's not a good reason to do it that way. Yeah, the Cree's, I think, are very good. And I'm interested in this new Philips flat design, which looks really interesting. It doesn't have a heat sink, which is a big issue with LED bulbs because it's, that's the Cree. See that big heat sink? And it's heat's a real issue with LEDs because it makes them wear out faster. So the new Philips is flat. It's kind of cool. Let's see if I can find it. Yeah, I don't see it on their site yet. They're selling it, I want to say, at Home Depot. Only one. Somebody has an exclusive. They're really cool. Does CNET like them? Is this it? Yeah, this is it. It's kind of an interesting idea. Because it's shaped like that, they don't need to see. They eliminate the heat sink. Because the LEDs are in these. It's basically, the middle is a heat sink. Why don't we get a bunch of these? Philips says they're going to be $10. So they're about the same as the Cree. Oh, Cree is a style, not a brand? Oh, I didn't know that. Well, I didn't know that. What about exporting a file that Carbonite... Carbonite doesn't recognize or not recognize anything. It's like any backup. Backup just doesn't know what's going on. It just makes a copy of your files. So it copies what you tell it to copy. Yeah, I thought Cree was a manufacturer. Yeah, there it is. Philips at Home Depot. And it's dimmable, which I really like. $10. See? I want to get like 1,000 of those. I love these. $10. It's dimmable. I should just order a bunch of them, huh? Woo, woo, woo. Hello, everybody. Leo Laporte here, the tech guy. Time to talk computers and the internet. Cell phones, camcorders, MP3 players, and light bulbs at 888-88-ASK-LEO. 888-827-5536. Toll free from anywhere in the U.S. Everybody in the chat, when we're talking about light bulbs, we'll get back to that in a second. Talk a little bit about this. Because, you know, it's now illegal to sell a 40 or 60 watt, anywhere from 40 to 60 watt incandescent bulbs in the U.S. Unless they're for a chandelier or, you know, some specialty purpose. So people are looking. Nobody wants compact fluorescent. I think we've gotten over that. So the question is LED bulbs. We'll talk a little bit about some advances in LED light bulbs. But before the break, I think we finished up with David. So I think this would be a good time to talk about light bulbs. So Philips at. I believe it was at CES announced a new LED light bulb they started selling this week that doesn't have a heat sink. So LED seems to me to be the way to go. They last 10 years. They use very little power. I mean, that's the main reason that the feds have banned incandescent lights is they're just horrendously inefficient. You know that because they're so hot. that a lot of the energy that you're pumping in, electricity you're pumping in, is just dissipated as heat, not light. Compact fluorescents have other issues. There's mercury in them, most of them, so there's pollution issues. I don't like them for a number of other reasons. I don't like the light that comes out of them. They take a little while to warm up, so they start dim and they warm up. There are a lot of reasons not to like CFLs. And I think a lot of reasons to like LEDs, but one of the big problems with LEDs has been the heat sink. They do generate heat. They need a fairly large heat sink because heat is bad for LEDs. It'll shorten their life. Philips has created a new kind of LED. They call it the Slim Style. They're selling it right now exclusively at the Home Depot. A couple of points to make on this. First of all, because they've eliminated the expensive heat sink, these are $10 for 60-watt equivalent. And they're dimmable, which was another negative on LEDs, was you couldn't use your dimmers. Dimmable, the color looks pretty good, and they're $10 each. Now, remember, they're going to last 10 times longer than your regular light bulb. So this is a good economy. They use a lot less power than a regular light bulb to get 60 watts of light. I'm very intrigued by it. To the point where I think I'm going to buy, you know, a bunch of them, because whenever I need to replace bulbs, I don't want to replace the incandescent with another incandescent. I don't really want to replace it with a compact fluorescent. I think this is the way to go. What do you think? Now, somebody in the chat room saying, what about the Switch Infinia? And see, it has a heat sink, too. The heat sink makes them bulky. I'm not crazy about the heat sinks. These Philips are funny looking. If you look at them front on, they look like a light bulb. But if you look at them from the side, they're skinny. They're thin. And this is how they eliminated the heat sink. The LEDs are in a circular ring, a light bulb-shaped ring, around glass in the middle. The glass in the middle acts as a heat sink. And because of the way the LEDs are spread out, they say we don't need to make heat sinks. So they are funny looking, but I think we could get used to it. I'm intrigued. And boy, especially at $10. Now, these are soft white. They're 2,700 degrees Kelvin. That's a decent color. I don't know. I'm intrigued. I use a lot of Philips LEDs, these Hue LEDs that they make. They're expensive. They're $60 each. But they're programmable. You can have them make any color you want. They have RGB, red, green, and blue LEDs in there. And you can tune them to make anything from white to blue to green to sunset if you want. So it's an interesting idea. But they're expensive. I don't know. I like LEDs. I think we're going somewhere. But that's just my thought. Joe is in North Hollywood. Joe Leo Laporte, the tech guy.
Hello. You're a natural resource. Yes, yes, I love it. When, I mean, you know, you're my only hero, okay?
Your only hero? I shouldn't be your hero.
I have no more. Well, JFK, baby.
All right. That's a good start, yeah.
Listen.
Me and JFK. Yes, sir.
Yeah. I'm not going to give you my age, but I'm going to tell you that I still have my post-slight rule.
Wow. Were the posts yellow or white? Are those the bamboo ones or are they the metal ones?
Yeah. Oh, no. It's got to be bamboo.
Oh, those are the best.
Yeah.
Oh, I love those.
Oh, it can do everything. I think I still know how to use it for some things.
But you know what I want? Do you remember in school, because we're both obviously the same age, in school to teach you how to use the slide. Now, everybody under 40 is going, what's a slide rule? Before calculators, we used a mechanical method of doing math that involved, sometimes they call it a slip stick. You'd move these pieces around and you had a little cursor you'd move around, but it worked. And remember in school, they had a giant one, like an 8-foot one that the teacher could demonstrate on. If anybody has one of those, let me know. I'll buy it from you. I want to hang it right here in the studio. And then the young people come in and say, what is that? Well, before there were calculators. Somewhere between abacuses and calculators.
Yeah, it was a mechanical calculator.
That's right.
I took a class in that and also another semester on slide rule. No kidding. And you say we're the same age. Hell no, we're not the same age.
There's a skill. I took a class in slide rule.
Yes, I took a skin. You know, that's all we had. We didn't, and now what? When the little calculator four function.
Yeah.
You're not allowed to use those because only the rich guys could afford them.
They were hugely expensive. They were thousands of dollars.
Oh yeah, I know. But you know, anyway, that dates me. But anyway, I had a comment. I bought a Nova screen, a Nova beam.
Oh, the Nova beam, yeah.
Yes, front projection, one speaker.
That's about as old as a slide rule.
Well, no. This was because the guy invented it the early 80s.
Yeah, it was the early, in fact, sometimes you see them in bars still, the early projector TVs.
Yeah,
they had the three beams, red, green, and blue beams.
Exactly.
Curved screen.
Yes, curved screen, Leo.
Yeah.
You, I don't know if you must know what it is.
I remember. I used to go to bars that had Nova beams.
Yeah, they're mounted on the ceiling.
It was dim. Yeah, it was dim. You could barely see it, but it was big.
Oh, yeah, the conference. Oh, yeah, the conference is 300 inch or something like
that. Yeah.
But anyway, mine is only 60 inch. But either way, the curved screen, like I said, it's front projection.
You know why they did that? They had to do it.
Go ahead.
They had to do it because in those days, it would handle the distortion issue with the image. So so if you flatten it out, the image would be distorted at the edges. So they curved it because of the lenses that they were using. They had to do that.
Yeah.
That is not why the new TVs that we saw at CES are curved. They're not curved for any good reason.
No. The Nova Beam had a curved screen because it had only one speaker in the front projector, and it would bounce the sound back, and it sounded like a movie theater.
Oh, that's interesting. So it was using the curvature to amplify the sound.
Yeah, so if you sit a little bit under it, it sounds like you're in a big cave. No kidding. I still have it.
Yours is working, the bulbs and everything, or you were able?
Everything is, because I hardly ever used it, you know. I'm that way.
That is a great thing to have. You should put that in a display in a museum, Joe.
A museum?
along with your slide rule.
I'm a history guy. Yeah. And I have every camera I'd ever used way back to the Polaroid.
I didn't even get to your question. I was having so much fun. Hang on, Joe. We got to take a break. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. It's like being in a cave. I don't know if that's a good thing. So where can I buy a giant slide rule? 7-foot slide rule. I suddenly have a hankering. Look at these. You can get lots of them on eBay. Faber-Castell. Remember these circular slide rules? These were very compact, very easy to... I had quite a few. I have to admit, I kind of collected these. Whoops. Whoops. Where was I? Let's open last time. Engineering slide rules. There's a whole section on eBay of slide rules. Faber-Castell. Oh, look at that. K&E in leather case. K&E in leather case, baby. Oh, and it's like ivory. $14. I'm going to buy it now, man. Buy it now, man. You get it now. The cursor doesn't look like it's in too good shape. Jeez. That's what would happen. The spring would go wonky in there, and then you wouldn't get accurate results. There's the pickets. Oh, giant 84-inch picket. I want $550. I want it. Look how big that is. 84-inch picket yellow slide rule.
Oh, my God.
That's the one I want.
Is that it leaning up against a garage?
Yes.
It is.
They did these were for instruction purposes, so the teacher could do do it in the show.
Oh, so the whole class could see.
Yeah. A lot of math classrooms had these hanging up. See, wow. It's got the hooks on the side so you can hang it up. But it would be great for the studio. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Joe, Joe, you got me in trouble. Now I'm buying slide rules on eBay. I'm buying...
Hey, Leo.
Yeah, Joe. Yeah. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Oh, yes, Joe.
Okay. Let's see, the curved screen. We're doing that.
Yeah, we're done with the slide rules. We're done with the curved screen. What's next? You got a question for me?
I use clear Christmas lights to light. Let's see. The next one is...
okay, what else?
my real question.
Yes.
I made a 15-year quantum jump in my computer.
Congratulations.
And, by the way, I still have the MS-DOS computer at 386.
What?
Everything away. I have all the computers I ever owned.
Okay.
You know, starting with the Instamatic and all the way up to, well, I quit at the, what was it called? AE1? Canon.
Oh, yeah. So that's film. That's a film camera.
Yeah, film camera. Canon.
Yeah, Canon.
Oh, I don't know. Five lenses I had, you know.
What can you have a, as much as I'm enjoying this trip down memory lane through Joe's closet, do you have a question, Joe?
Yes, I have a question. I bought what is way, way, way more than I ever need because I'm updating. I've got a...
Joe, how big is your house? Is it like endless?
Well, the thing is that it's not big because I live alone.
Joe, I think I knew that.
I have movies, I have televisions, I have all things. I don't throw anything away. I still have my film projector.
Oh, my. This is good.
Anyway,
you should have a yard
Leo.
Sale, Joe. Oh, I'm coming over for the yard sale.
Oh, no, I'm almost dead. You won't be. I'll put you in my will.
Put me in your will.
My only heir.
Okay, I'll take it.
Okay. Oh!
I want the Nova Beam.
The Nova Beam. I was going to give it to some poor family.
No, give it to some poor family, please. Please, I beg of you, do not give it to me.
It's only a monitor, though, you know. Yeah. But it doesn't matter. It'll take any type of source.
I think, Joe, you could be a reality series all by yourself.
That's what I was going to suggest for you.
Yeah. Do we have cameras follow me around? No, thank you.
People don't know about you, Leo.
Oh, they know everything about me. There are no secrets, Joe.
No, they don't. The high school kids that are puzzling over their damn
life. Well, that's true. They don't know anything about me.
Exactly. Yeah. They be just listening to you. It's great. Anyway, hey. I bought, along with the supercomputer, I bought a 27-inch monitor for Samsung.
Good.
Okay. And the guy that sold it to me says, why don't you just get a flat screen TV, a little one?
No, he's nuts. That's not true at all. Okay. Big difference. Big difference.
That was my question.
Yeah, so the difference between a TV and a monitor. A TV has a tuner in it, has circuitry for displaying video, and most importantly, the TV is lower resolution. It doesn't need to be high resolution.
Yeah.
Right? Even a high-def TV is only 1,080 lines from top to bottom. That 27-inch monitor, what is the resolution on that? It's more than 1080.
Oh, yeah, 29-something.
Yeah.
1950, yeah. Something like
so
that.
What happens is people watch this on a TV. TV's not designed to be as crisp and acute as a computer monitor because you're sitting across the room from it. So if you're putting it on a computer and you're going to be sitting at arm's length, you want a better screen than your TV screen.
Okay, so I won't use my analog TV with the...
Use the Nova Beam.
I cut the cord anyway.
It's perfect for DOS.
Anyway... I use Christmas lights for lighting.
Yes. A lot of people do because you're too lazy to take them down.
Well, they're clear inside.
Hey, the new Christmas lights are LED, right? That's a good idea. They'll never burn out.
Exactly. And then you can take out some of the bulbs or whatever, you know? Come on. Anyway, where is my holographic TV?
Oh, you want a three-dimensional image in your living room. Joe, hang in there.
I'm talking about 30 years ago. We used to use it to inspect parts.
What?
From overseas.
Were you an engineer? What did you do, Joe?
I was a metallurgist.
A metallurgist. Oh, wow.
Metallurgical engineer, and then I transformed it to a demo officer, and then I transformed into a aerospace.
Fascinating. Well, I'll tell you, you've seen a lot of changes over the last 50 years. Absolutely. Here's an interesting thing, Joe. We talked yesterday about a new technology that's going to be used. This was one thing, I think, maybe the most interesting thing at CES. Now, it's being used for a completely stupid, trivial purpose, 3D TV. And it's using a kind of technology that is, I think, very interesting. It was first discovered 150 years ago by Michael Faraday. And as a metallurgist, you'll know the name Faraday, of course, a great physicist from the 19th century. So we were talking about this yesterday with Scott, and I find it very intriguing. It's using a technique, and I'm trying to remember the name of it. Chat room will remember the technique. What was it? Light ray? Light wave. And now I have always said you can't do glasses-free 3D because you got to get two different images from a screen, and then each eye has to see one, the left image and the right image. How are you going to do that without polarizing glasses or colored glasses? Well, light wave technology can do this by sending different images, it's very interesting, into the eye. Well, I realized, yes, that would certainly make it possible to do glasses-free 3D, but it would also make possible 3D holographic TV. Who needs a screen? Suddenly, the screen isn't the most important part of your television. You could project it in the middle of the room. So I suspect with all of this technique and technology and physics going on, who cares about 3D? Let's have a holographic display in the middle of the room. I wouldn't be surprised to see this sooner than you think. If they're really making this kind of advances in light wave. Michael Faraday talked about it in 1846. But maybe it'll be coming. Or light field, that's it. Yeah, not light wave. Light field technology. There's a camera, the Lytro, that uses the same thing, takes one image with multiple focal lengths so that you could decide after you take the picture what's in focus and what's not in focus. Same idea, light field technology. Very intriguing. Very intriguing. Joe, great talking to you. Call back again. And by the way, be careful when you have so much stuff that you don't have any landslides or anything in there, because I want to hear from you every week so we know you're okay. I've been buried by all the junk in your house. Light field technology, very intriguing. Coming up in just a bit, speaking of photography, our photographic expert, our guru of the digital, Chris Marquardt. 8888-ASK-LEO is the phone number. The website, techguylabs.com. Techguylabs.com. You'll find a link to our chat room there and a whole lot more. More to come in just a little bit. You're listening to the Tech Guy Show. 8888 Ask Leo. Lytro. Do they still sell the Lytro camera? I think it was a silly kind of a thing. But we'll ask Chris Marquardt about it. You could do holographic projections that way. Leo Laporte, the Tech Guy. The Technology Hoarders would be a great show for us today. Technology Hoarders. Hey, did you ever play with a Lytro, Chris?
Hello. Yes, I did briefly. It's still around. They still sell it, but
it's a gimmick. I knew it was a gimmick when they.
You know, I mean, the pictures that come out. Yes, you can focus them after the fact, but it's kind of. I mean, you're getting like one point something megapixel images out of that. So
silly. But I'm telling you, they can make some advances on this thing. If they're using it for 3D TV, I think light field could be used.
I think they're still fighting the low resolution, because what they do is in order to do that, they kind of split up the, 16, 20 megapixel chip into lots of small pieces and parts, and that reduces the amount of pixels that they
have. Apparently, there were TVs at CES using this technology to do glasses-free 3D.
Yeah, with a TV, you might be off a bit better, because HD is only 2 megapixels. So
right,
you probably have a chance to do it there. Possibly. I also have a note about CFLs and LEDs and incandescent lights.
Yeah.
Because I'm still a real huge fan of incandescent lights. And that has to do with the visible spectrum, the continuity of the spectrum.
Frank Gore! Oh, I love you, Frankie! I love you, baby! I'm sorry. Pay no attention.
Sorry, Chris. It's just football.
Ow, my ear. Anyway, take a deep breath.
So, now in Germany, do they still allow the sale of incandescent light bulbs?
Some special ones. They actually now have regular light bulbs with a small halogen light in it. And there are lots of CFLs, lots of LEDs, so yeah, it's switching over as well.
I remember when Australia banned the incandescent. I thought, what? That's nuts. Little did I know.
You know what? The digital cameras have the hardest time getting the colors right with CFLs and with LEDs because the spectrum, the visible spectrum that they use is not continuous. It has holes and it has big holes.
Oh, that's terrible. Yeah.
So even where with an incandescent light bulb, you'd have a camera, a digital photo and your eyes, and you could kind of trust what you see with your eyes is what comes out. With a CFL and an LED, you have to make test shots because what you see is different than what your camera sees. So this is really a big issue for Hollywood, for example. They have to shoot lots of tests with LED lights because they can't judge with their eyes if the colors are going to come out the way they want them to. it's a weird thing, but obviously they save a lot of energy and they are...
We use LED lighting here. I mean, I'm lit by LEDs right now.
Mm-hmm. And the color looks good. I mean,
yeah. I do have a big fluorescent above me. But, I mean, nobody uses incandescent anymore in television. It's too expensive and too hot. Yeah. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. He's Chris Marquardt. Our digital photography guru joins us every week to talk about photography, the busts, photographic myths, and more. You can find him at chrismarquardt.com and discoverthetopfloor.com. Hi, Chris.
Hello, Leo. Let's bust a myth today about stability.
Stability.
Well, you hear that with today's cameras, you kind of don't need to stabilize yourself because the camera does everything for you. You shoot with really high ISOs, and the cameras have built-in stabilizers and things. And you know, with the older cameras with lower ISOs, you'd have camera shake sometimes because you didn't hold them steady enough. And the myth is you don't need to stabilize because the cameras do it all for you.
Yeah, I just hold my camera, I shake my hand all around and everything.
Yeah, but you know, you will inevitably be in light situations where you need stability. Yeah. So what I've brought you is 7 techniques that will give you a lot more stability. Simple.
Do not rely on the camera. Do it yourself.
Well, the more you do it yourself, the better you can. I mean, we just hit Christmas and people were shooting under the Christmas tree with very little light, and that just ends up with a lot of pictures that you can not use. So, technique number one: elbows in. If you hold the camera up, even if it's your iPhone or something, if you hold it up like this, if you put the elbows in, if you press them against your rib cage, that will give you more stability. That will just give you less camera shake. That's number one.
You're using your body as a
you're using
stabilizer,
the body as
kind of.
Kind of a stabilizer, yeah. If you have an SLR or a smaller camera, or any camera at all, your stance, what do you do with your feet? Are you on tiptoes? Do you have both feet flat on the ground? That's a good idea, maybe a bit apart, not too close together. That will give you more stability. Third thing is lean against a wall. Put your elbows on a table. Just connect yourself with something that is stable.
Yeah, I hate carrying around a tripod, which of course is the best way to get stability. So yeah, I'm always looking for something to lean on or put the camera on.
Yeah, the world is our tripod, right?
Yeah.
here's a big thing. If you have a heavy DSLR, that is especially important, where you would hold the camera. You know, the right-hand side has this grip, which kind of suggests that that's where you hold it. And what people do is they hold it there and they support the entire weight of the camera with the right hand, which is also the hand that presses the shutter button.
Oh.
And that makes it not stable. If you have this thing and you start shaking because you have like 2 pounds of camera in your hand and then pressing the shutter button, that's not stable. No, what professional photographers do is they use the left hand and use it as a platform to sit the camera on top. So now your left hand is carrying the entire weight. And if you take that left elbow against your ribcage, it's pretty much your body is taking the entire weight of the camera. And now the right hand can manipulate the camera, press a shutter button without having to carry any weight. And this way you get like tons more stability.
A little harder to do with a point and shoot because you don't have a big lens sticking out maybe. Yeah. But
that is true. But no, still a little point and shoot. There's
still something you can hold. Yeah.
Let me show you this one. The ones watching the video can see it. This is the smallest SLR. It's a tiny film SLR.
That's cute. A little Pentax.
From somewhere in the 80s. Even that one you can put on this platform and then look through and shoot. It works really well.
In other words, use both hands.
Use both hands. Yeah. But the left hand carries the weight. That is kind of one of the rules here. Right hand doesn't carry any weight. Then if you shoot in portrait format, if you flip the camera 90 degrees, which hand do you put on top? The right hand or the left hand?
Now, I'm going to have to think about that. I don't...
Think about that. Yeah. Well, the secret is if you put the right hand on the bottom, that's the one that presses the shutter button.
So put the button again, button down.
No, if you do that, then you have a very kind of cramped stance there.
Yeah.
If you, again, keep the left hand as the platform that the camera sits on,
so
your
up.
Right hand is free to move and do... Yeah. Everything. So it's the shutter button is on the up. And
put the button you up. Have, yeah.
And then last but not least, if you have an electronic viewfinder or an optical viewfinder, something that you look through with your eye, then touch the camera against your eyebrow. Use your head.
Use your head.
That is another point of stability. That will help you shoot at even longer shutter speeds at almost a darkness. Yeah, with your
it doesn't work on a camera phone or the point and shoots that don't have viewfinders. But if you have a viewfinder,
but there are plenty of people who got DSLRs for Christmas. Right. So,
but everything else is true with a camera phone is use both hands and support it with your left hand and shoot with your right and all of that. Yeah.
Yes.
Good stuff. Chris Marquardt is the photo guy at the Tips from the Top Floor podcast. It's a great show to listen to, and you'll find that in all his workshops at Discover the Top Floor. We have an assignment, don't we?
We have an assignment. The current assignment is departure.
Departure. So what does that mean, folks? Well, it means go out and take an image that illustrates the concept departure. We're not going to tell you what that means. Just departure. And what you'll do with that picture is tag it with the word departure, upload it to Flickr, flickr.com, that's free. You do have to create an account, but it's a free account. And then submit it to the Tech Guy Photo Group. Renee Silverman, our moderator there, will welcome you to the group if you're not already a member. And once a week, you can add another photo to it, and in about 2 or 3 weeks, we'll review those. I guess we did it last week, so you got 3 more weeks to take pictures.
Exactly.
Departure.
Cool stuff already. I like the one with the toast.
Toast?
There's some really... A toast is spitting out tins of slices of toast.
Departure of the toast.
That's sort of a departure there.
Do you... somebody in the chat room saying, what camera phone do you use? I mean, you, of course, you're professional, so you use real cameras, but you must have a smartphone. Is there one you like?
Well, the one that I currently use is an iPhone 5. So
that's a great
not even
camera.
A 5S, but the camera is pretty good. Camera. And I would use that in a pinch if I don't have another camera with me. That's the one I will use. And I make it a habit to every now and then on my Flickr stream, if you look, there will be an iPhone photo on it. Just wedged in between all the DSLR photos. And most of the time, people don't even notice.
It's the camera you have, right? And sometimes just having a camera, even if it's just a camera phone, I got a really cute shot. And I did it with the Galaxy Note 3, which actually is a pretty good 13-megapixel camera. I'm actually very impressed. It's the same camera as in the Galaxy S4, probably the best Android camera. And we blew it up. It was such a good shot. We blew it up to 8x10. It looks great. I just saw it the other day. Lisa framed it, put it on the bookshelf. It looks great.
Absolutely.
And I'm blown away. It was in indoor, dim indoor light. It wasn't, but I had the camera phone. I snapped that picture quickly. They were giving Ozzy a bath, and it was the cutest little picture. And I'm so glad.
The amount of computation that goes into these photos to make them look this good is amazing, especially with the smaller cameras. But now also with a lot of the system cameras, the Sony RX100, for example, is one of those cameras that does enormous amounts of computation to kind of even out the things that the lens does to the pictures. So that's another topic we can talk about one day.
By the way, I have that RX100, the Mark II. I love that camera.
I'll send you a link that this is a cool camera, but they have a lens on it that is subpar and
really
a lot of computation to iron it out. The lens produces a lot of distortion, but that is by design, so they could fit in the smallest lens possible. So they deliberately made the lens worse and added computation to iron out the issues that the lens has.
It
works really well.
It's a very good low light camera. I mean, it's a like yes. F2. It's really good.
Yes, it isn't
that interesting? I had no idea. So it's a terrible camera.
No,
very expensive. It's $700. Well, I get great images out of it. That's what blows me away, you know?
Yeah. And most Micro Four Thirds cameras do that nowadays. A lot of cameras add computation to help you get better pictures.
It's the future, isn't it, of photography. It's what we've called before computational photography.
I think it is, and it kind of hurts because, you know, I love good glass. I love lenses that are really, really good, but it's too expensive.
Too expensive. Chris Marquardt, discoverthetopfloor.com. Thank you, Chris. Always a pleasure. We'll talk to you next week. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. More of your calls right after this. It is, in fact, the digital photographic equivalent of "We'll fix it in post." So the last last tips from the top floor was all about that.
Well, here's a New Year's website tip for
it. Right? Your last podcast was all about that, somebody said.
Let me just send you that link because that gives you a picture of the original.
It's that
picture
bad.
Without the correction.
I think Sony's really interesting what they're up to. They're very much going to computational photography.
Okay, go to tfttf.com/Friedman. FRIEDMANRX 100. Mm-hmm. And they deliberately designed it that way because
that was the only way they could fit the Brothers in Mountains.
Go one episode down, great pictures.
I talked about this in the last episode. Look at this beautiful picture. That is a gorgeous picture.
And it's deliberately distorted.
Yeah. See the barrel distortion?
And if you click at let me find the link for you in that under that episode. Yeah, just the top link underneath the most distortion.
The most distortion read in Zeiss lens ever. See, Zeiss is just a name now, right?
Scroll further down and you see the uncorrected and the corrected one.
Yeah.
See that?
Wow, it's blue.
Isn't that amazing the amount of correction they do?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, isn't that amazing? But I think you're seeing that more and more. I think even big, good cameras with good glass does a lot of this.
Of course.
Yeah.
Of course. Leica does that with the M9. They do it with the S series.
Right.
Hasselblad does it with their digital cameras now.
And they're building this stuff in the Lightroom, too. I mean, Lightroom will correct for this kind of error.
And actually, the RX100 pictures, if you shoot a RAW and you import it into Lightroom, Lightroom gets the one with the distortions, and under the hood, it corrects those.
Yeah, exactly.
It looks at the metadata, and it does an under-the-hood correction. Mm-hmm. It's not getting a corrected picture.
That's
so,
right. Of
course, they don't really advertise that, you know?
They kind of do, because they've been talking about how they're adding lens corrections for a lot of cameras now in ACR and Adobe Camera Raw.
Yeah, but they don't show the...
They don't tell you how bad it is.
Corrected images, no.
It's really fascinating.
It is.
But as long as the distortion, the error is consistent, which this is, easy to fix.
Well, they build a profile and they know at what focal length of the zoom lens it is how bad. And then this way they have this profile that they just tell Lightroom it's at, I don't know, 15 millimeters and at that focus. And Lightroom knows what to do.
I finally broke down and bought the Creative Suite. But I did the photo. They had a deal on the photographic one, $10 a month for Photoshop
the
plus
photo
Lightroom.
Bundle. I have that too. Yeah,
that's not a $10 a month, $120 a year, and you get Photoshop and Lightroom. That's pretty good.
Yeah, I was in the habit of skipping a year with Photoshop because I didn't need all the brand new features. But on the other hand, I do two photo podcasts.
This is your business.
Yeah. I talk about these things, so I have to be kind of at the forefront.
It's not such a good deal for me because I already bought Lightroom, right? But I won't have to buy the next upgrade. So, I just
hope they don't throw in any updates that destabilize things.
Right. Yeah, because you're stuck with it. You have to, it's hard not to update. I guess you could.
Well, I don't know if you can decline an update. I'm not sure.
I don't know.
It's like Google delivering the Nick plugins update, like behind the scenes, without people knowing about it.
Oh, did that upset people?
Well, a few with SSDs who all of a sudden had like a gigabyte more stuff on their drive.
Yeah.
So.
I got the new Mac Pro.
I envy you. I'm not gonna get one, but it's still.
It's pretty nice.
Yeah,
All right, Chris. See ya. Thank you.
See you next week. Take care.
Bye-bye. This is nice. I don't know what version of this is, but this is, I guess, a live Doobie Brothers. Leo Laporte, the tech guy, 8888 Ask Leo, a tip of a hat, a nod of the derby to Nathan Staten, our musical director, picking up some good stuff here. 888-827-5536. That's the phone number. Our next caller comes from Long Beach, California. Augustine is on the line. Hi, Augustine.
How are you doing?
I'm well. Leo?
Thanks. Thanks for taking my call. Listen, my wife and I are like hammers and hummers. Maybe that's not a...
I like it. I don't know what it means, but I like it. Hammers and hummers. Yes, I like it.
Hemming and humming over, buying a new computer.
Ah.
And we do that with every piece of technology that we buy, and we've never lost. So we just stick to it. But we're really trying to decide between the MacBook Pro and the MacBook Air. Not quite sure which one to get. We've read things that are like, they say, equally, yes, you should get it, and no, you should get this one, or no, you should get the other.
You're talking to the right guy. I own both.
Oh, cool. Okay.
Because I couldn't decide either. I'm a hemmer and a har as well.
Okay.
So here's the difference. It's a very clear difference, really.
Okay.
The MacBook Pros are the highest-end laptops Apple makes, so they have the fastest processors, the fastest graphics cards, and the best screens. And, of course, the MacBook Pros are a Retina, which means very high resolution, very high dot-per-inch screens. Beautiful.
Okay.
However, as you would imagine, they're heavy and they're big compared to the MacBook Air, which is a gorgeous light beauty. A slim beauty, but the screen is not Retina. It's lower. Now, there is a funny little thing here because the battery life on the MacBook Air is stunning. 13 hours on the 13-inch, or 12 hours. It's stunning. So what you have to do is decide, well, what is it we're looking for? Is it thin, light, portable, excellent battery life? Are we going to be going out of the house all the time using it? Or do you use this as a desktop replacement? You want the best possible image, the fastest processing, and all of that.
Yeah, it's more of a desktop thing. I mean, my wife does take it to work, but it's not like, maybe once or twice a week.
MacBook isn't that heavy. It's heavier, but it's certainly portable. It's a laptop. Now, I have a 15-inch MacBook Pro with Retina. It is, in many ways, among the fastest Macs Apple makes. So it's if you're doing, now you may not, are you doing Photoshop? Are you doing video editing? Are you doing anything?
No, my wife, she uses it for, processing, emailing, we probably will store photos and, other media. But nothing too fancy, honestly. She likes the fact that it has a DVD, /CD drive, other than that, we're not really, it's not like we're doing anything major on it.
Mine doesn't have a DVD CD drive, so I don't know what you're talking about.
Oh, it doesn't? Really? Okay.
The lower end ones do, but they have stopped in the higher end.
Okay, see, and that was the thing that I do have a friend who's a technician, and he said that, those are kind of, the ones with the CD, DVD drive are kind of going.
Yeah, because physical media is dead.
Okay.
I like saying that because it drives people crazy. There's always somebody in the chat room say, "You're crazy. They're not physical media." Yes, it's dead. It's dead. It's going. It's gone the way of the dinosaur. So yeah, there is still one MacBook Pro that has an optical drive built into it, but it's not. I don't think it's the highest end one. I think it's It's designed for schools.
Okay. Yeah, and that's what we were looking at. I'm a teacher, and so looking at using the educator.
You can always get the external super drive.
Okay.
And so that's not a bad thing to have as an external super drive, because that way you don't have to carry it around with you, but you can carry it around with you.
Okay.
I haven't cut to the chase here at all. I understand that. So the you will not get retina display if what you want is an optical drive. Okay, that's they just keep that around as for fun, for grins. The retina displays 13 and 15 do not have, as far as I know, do not have optical drives. So let's eliminate the optical drive. Just get a super drive. It's under $100. It's an easy thing to add. I personally, huh?
What's a super drive? Is
that's their external drive.
Okay.
And it, you know what? You'll find you don't use it very much, I suspect. Maybe in education, you're getting a lot of CD-ROMs with stuff on them.
For you to say, it's dead, I'm like, no, we still want to hang on to that kind of
thing. Give it up.
They need some with a VCR thing, too. That would be awesome.
Yeah, I understand. Schools have different needs. I completely understand.
Okay.
So that's the choice. Now, I can't make the choice for you. If you're traveling, there's nothing like an Air. I mean, it's so light. It's like floating like a feather. But there is no Air with a CD either.
Right.
The display, there is no better display in the world, I think, than the MacBook Pro with Retina. It's gorgeous.
Okay.
But in either case, you don't need to get the top of the line because you're not doing anything super demanding.
No. Yeah. I mean, that makes it almost an easier choice, right? Well, thank you. I appreciate your help and your wisdom.
I don't know if that's wisdom, but that's the difference. And, I couldn't decide. I hemmed and hawed and bought both. Okay. And when I travel, I use a MacBook Air. But when I'm here at the studio, I'm using a MacBook Pro.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Thanks for the call.
You made my day.
I do like to tweak people a little bit. Physical media is dead. It's always fun to say something's dead. And nothing really ever dies in technology. Well, except zip disks. Those died. Floppy disks. I think they're pretty much dead. Except for a few government agencies who still use them. CRT displays. Yeah, they're pretty much gone. So I think optical discs in the next couple of years are, come on, really? That's what we invented the internet for. VHS tapes, yeah, they're pretty much gone. Corey in Albert Lea, Minnesota. Hi, Corey.
Hey, how are you, Leo? I'm so glad to talk to you.
I'm thrilled. Now, we're probably going to have to take a break, so we'll get started, and then we'll continue you over if you don't mind.
All right, that sounds fine. My girlfriend has a MacBook Pro and hates it for school, and she wants Microsoft software on it or a Microsoft computer.
You don't need to buy a new computer. The MacBook Pro is a very good Windows machine.
Yep, you can run boot camp and et cetera like that. But she doesn't want to do it, and she's 200 miles that way. So
that's fine. At this point, it is all about personal preference. It is not about – there's no religious war here. It's what you like, so that's fine. Yeah, she'll be getting Windows 8.1. You say she wants Office, there's two forms of Windows. There's one for Intel, but there's one for ARM that comes with Office.
Yep, running the tablet-type version.
Yeah, it's called Windows RT.
And that's where my question is. Because this would be she uses her, she's like a cord never had anything. So she actually does use physical media, believe it or not. And she's got the external drive, and she has a whole bunch of DVDs, and she has Netflix and all this other stuff.
The best Windows machine out there is the Lenovo Carbon X1. They have a touch version if you're using Windows 8. It is fantastic, and I think she would probably love it. Leo Laporte, the tech guy.
Get an app I want to show you.
Yes, John. Show me an app.
Probably an app you don't have.
Okay.
But I love it because Exoplanet, it gives me notifications whenever we discover a new planet around another star.
Anytime we discover a new star, it gives us a notification. Here, put it down here on the special Twit platform. Anytime we discover, and how often do we discover an exoplanet?
Every day
there's a new exoplanet.
You can see where they are in relation.
You know, the next, I think it's the next Frontline. You got to watch Frontline this week.
I love Frontline.
It's all about that, exoplanets.
But I was playing around, and I discovered in this add-ons thing, I was scrolling around, and I saw this option.
Philips Hue setup. So, wait a minute. My Hue can tell me when they've discovered a new planet? Will it show us the color of the planet?
No, it'll show you what it would be like to live on that planet.
Oh, I'm getting that. Oh, that's so super cool. Exoplanet.
Yeah, exoplanet.
And it will tell my Hue lights to give me the color of the star.
The new planet that's been discovered around.
Isn't that awesomeness?
XO as in kiss hug?
EXO.
Oh.
As in external.
Yeah, I was just looking around and saying, oh, I know who has Hue lights.
Yeah, I have 9 Hue lights. I haven't set up the Hue base station, though, but I will. I love the daydream feature on Android when you're using. So wireless charging, you just put this down. This becomes a photo, a slideshow app, which is kind of cool. Because it's charging on my little tilt. You may ask, does the Note 3 support wireless charging? No, it does not. But it does now, because look at this. This is the funniest little thing. It's just a little doohickey. And I guess they support wireless charging to the extent that they put contacts there for this. So it has a little stickum on it. And it just magically does heat the phone up quite a bit. Magically charges. So you push that in there. Okay, and it's very skinny. It doesn't take any space, so I don't have to use a special back or anything. And now I have Qi charging on my Samsung Galaxy Note 3. Is that not sweet? It is sweet. See?
You have placed the device within range. Now charging will begin.
Well, no, I'll tell you who does. Me, because this sits on my desk, right? So I have, that's what's nice about this stand, is you just sit it on your desk. And I get a nice little slideshow. Could also do this if you wanted to see it slideways. It'll charge that way, too. So, nice. There is not a Moto X version of this, alas. Well, there is a Daydream. That's normal in Android. But you have to plug it in because there's no wireless charging on the Moto X. You can't take the back off. No, I don't think Samsung will do a Google Edition ROM on the Note 3. There's just too much stuff because of the stylus. They're not going to... I will do more of that, Jackie. I think that was the best gaming stuff we ever did was the... I told Brushwood that. I said, we made a mistake with the game on. I should just watch people play. It was so fun to watch Schwood play. Leo Laporte, the Tech Guy, Hour 3 of the Tech Guy Show at 8888-ASK-LEO. That's the phone number. We were talking with Corey in Albert Lea, Minnesota. His girlfriend wants a new computer. She's done with Mac. Don't like it. Don't want it. She wants Microsoft Office. She wants a Windows machine. I do like that Lenovo X1. There are other choices, of course. Dell. Yeah. I have an Acer S7, which is super thin and light. The good news is in the Windows side, you have many choice.
Yep. Well, she doesn't hate her Mac. She loves it because she can watch all her stuff on it. But the problem with that is then she can't get buckled down to school.
That is a best backhanded compliment for Apple I've ever heard. I like it too much. It's too much fun.
Yep, yeah. I hear you. Yeah. So what I was thinking is, they have all these ARM tablets that run the Office, and they're relatively inexpensive. I mean, $300 or so, give or take.
Yeah.
Well, Office costs, and I haven't checked exactly, but it's in the 100 or 120 or $200, I'm sure, unless you do it subscription.
Well, that's now there are some Windows 8 Pro tablets that come with Office, like the Dell Venue Pro. So there are, if you shop around, there are tablets that come with Office and are full Windows. But I have to say, how does she feel about a tablet? What does she think about that?
She has no problem with the tablet. She used
as long as you have a physical keyboard, right? If you're going to do any typing or data entry, you got to have a physical keyboard. It's just too hard to type in glass. Yeah.
Oh, definitely, especially because she'll be doing reports and such. And this is basically just going to be a text machine.
I like the Surface, Microsoft Surface tablets, and they do offer touch covers, type covers, I should say, mm-hmm. that make them essentially laptops. that you can remove the cover, the keyboard from. Nokia's 2520 is really sweet.
That's Verizon.
And Verizon has it. That's right. Now,
well, that'd be interesting because I'm stuck with them.
Yeah. It's tiny. It's cute. I think she would like it in aesthetically. Now, remember, it's an 8-inch tablet, so it's not going to, or maybe it's maybe a little bigger, but it's not giant. Maybe it's 10-inch. It does come with Office, so you have a full Office. And at least for a while, they were offering a free keyboard cover. I don't know if they still are because it was delayed. So I would, yeah, talk to Verizon. I like the 2520. It comes with a full version of Office. It's a pretty sweet little tablet.
Okay. And I do have one quick question for you, if you're willing.
Yeah.
When do you think we'll see the 100-watt LEDs?
That's a good question. They're 60-watt equivalents now, and I think that's the sweet spot in the market because, of course, 40 to 60-watt incandescents are now banned.
Yep.
So they're going to say, well, we'll go there. I don't know why they don't make brighter. It must be because of this heat issue.
That would be my thinking.
Yeah, and maybe Philips with the slimline design has figured it out, and maybe we'll start to see brighter ones. I love LED bulbs. They're just, to me, this is the way to go.
Oh, I agree wholeheartedly, Leo. I work at a couple of hog farms, and there are hundreds of CFLs in here, and they go bad in a matter of 3 months.
I think CFLs, nightmare.
Yeah.
And when you spend that much money for a bulb, you don't want it to go bad in 3 months.
Oh, exactly.
Yeah. Is that because of the temperatures or what is, or the moisture?
Well, it's a terrible combination all the way around. Because the rooms have to be very warm for pigs to survive, and, you know, we're heating the place, and then it rises to the top, and then the CFL creates its own heat. I find them melted. I find them broken.
Yeah, I think that's
broken.
It. Yeah. So. Yeah. Hey, do you work in a hog farm, Corey?
I do.
What do you do?
Just about anything they tell me to.
I actually like hogs. I don't know how they would be in mass, but whenever we have the county fair here, I always go to the swine barn.
Oh, yeah?
I don't know why. Yeah. They seem to have a nice, you don't want to get in the pen with a big old sow, but hogs are kind of nice.
Yeah, they're not bad. You know, the little ones are kind of cute, and my girlfriend swears up and down that they're not because she sees what they grow up into, and I say,
yeah,
well,
they're cuter when they're little.
Uh-huh. Yeah, they're cute for about a week.
Hey, Corey, great to talk to you. Yeah, I think the 2520 is a great choice. What a nut. You are a good boyfriend. That is a lucky girl.
Yeah, well, I hope she thinks so.
Yeah, she better. She better. Hey, thanks, Corey.
Well, thank you very much, Leo.
My pleasure. Take care. Leo Laporte, the tech guy, 8888 Ask Leo. John's next in Oak Park, California. Hi, John.
Well, hello, Leo. How are you?
I'm well. How are you?
I'm doing pretty good. It's a pleasure talking to you.
My pleasure. What can I do for you?
Well, I've got something strange going on. I take music lessons on the internet.
Oh, how cool. What instrument?
Harmonica.
Oh, what a great idea. I'm a self-studied harmonica player. I need to get some lessons.
Yeah, if you want to play the blues, you got to.
Yeah. I can bend a note with the best of them, but I need some training. So good.
There you go.
All right.
Well, that's what I'm doing. I was trying to get the training.
Yeah.
And the teacher is using Adobe Connect Meetings.
Oh, interesting.
And my problem is I'm the only student that has extreme latency issues. And it's like 8 seconds all the time, and sometimes the video will freeze, the audio will drop out for 30 to 60 seconds. And we've gone to Adobe, and they go, everything's okay.
Yeah, no, it's not Adobe, probably. It's probably, well, there's several things it could be. It can be your hardware.
Mm-hmm.
It can be a computer that's not fast enough.
I've tried two different computers.
Okay. Then it's probably your internet connection. And sometimes, and we have this problem sometimes, it's an interaction between your internet service provider and Adobe's. Because Adobe hosts the meeting.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes these two different companies, sometimes they do something called peering, which means they have a special arrangement and data flows extra fast between them. But sometimes there's the opposite, where they're just kind of, they don't talk to each other well. And that's where the latency is. It's a delay over the internet from Adobe to you and back again. So what kind of internet service do you have?
I'm using Earthlink DSL and the 6 meg package.
Well, 6 meg should be plenty.
I'm getting a little over 2.
So here's where I would go is pingtest.net. A lot of people go to speedtest.net. It's not your speed, it's your latency. That's why that lag happens, right? Uh-huh. And what you're particularly looking at is jitter. So I would go to pingtest.net. It's run by the same people who do speed test. And take a look at that and see if it's in a reasonable range, under 100 milliseconds for sure. If it's not, then it's your internet service provider. Because this is talking between you and their servers. This doesn't involve Adobe at all. If your ping test looks good, then it's much more likely Adobe or the interaction between Adobe. It doesn't use, I mean, somebody in the chat room is saying less than a megabit. And I think if you have a megabit bandwidth, you should be all right. But the ping is also important, ping and jitter. You want to check those out and make sure you don't have super high ping and jitter. That's related to packet loss and latency, and those are two things that can kill you with something like that.
Okay.
And then if it is bad, then your choice is to either get a different internet service provider or perhaps a better package. DSL is usually pretty consistent. See here, I'm looking at mine. I have a ping of 34 milliseconds. That's excellent, and a jitter of 1, which is about as low as you can go. That's good, 1 millisecond jitter. But if you're getting higher numbers, this may be an indicator that that's what's going on.
Okay. Ping. What if my numbers are okay?
Then it could be an interaction between you and Adobe, or it could be your computer itself. You say it's the same thing's happened on a variety.
Yeah, I've used two different computers. I've tried it wired and wireless, and I've switched to an open DNS.
Yeah, it sounds like an internet service provider issue, and whether it's Earthlink or Earthlink to Adobe, I don't know. You might ask Adobe, do you guys have some specific issues with DSL from Earthlink? Because that's a possibility as well.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a tough one to figure out. It really is. Good luck. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. I want to hear some harmonica soon. It's not ping.net. It's ping test. Speed test gives you the ping, but doesn't give you the more important number, which is jitter. Oh, look at this. Here's an Adobe meeting test. This is good. This is a good way to do it. So let's put this in the show notes, too. Meeting connection diagnostic. This is good. Thank you for that. Good tip. See, 164 ping, 23 millisecond jitter is not ideal. That's not ideal. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. 8888 Ask Leo. That's the phone number if you have a question, a comment, a suggestion. We'll put in the show notes at techguylabs.com. By the way, that's the website to keep in mind. If you hear something on the show and you want to know more, techguylabs.com. We'll put in the show notes a link to a special site for Adobe Connect where you can test your connection. I don't know if you use that, John, or not, but that will also give you some diagnostic information. Give you some idea of what's going wrong. Yeah, if you're trying to learn an instrument, a 7-second delay, it's not going to make it easy. Not going to be easy. 8888 Ask Leo, the phone number. Let's go to Benny in Pasadena. Hi, Benny.
Hi, Leo.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Leo, I have a 10-year-old laptop on Windows XP.
Oh, yeah.
I know I'm in trouble. Be soon, right?
April 8th, you're going to have to face up to the music, I guess.
Right. So I'm looking at a tablet, and the Nexus 7 is...
Really nice.
Get your take on that.
I love the Nexus 7. Now, it's not Windows, so depends what you do with your computer. What do you do with it? Is it just email and surfing?
Pretty much,
There's no, for instance, Microsoft Office is not available.
What does that mean? Like, if I want to do a document, am I going to have to do it, like, on Google Docs?
Yes, basically. I mean, there are some third-party word processor apps and spreadsheet apps. There's QuickOffice. Google owns that. But essentially, you're going to use Google Docs. Not bad. I mean, unless there's a feature that you really need in Excel or Microsoft Word.
Okay, and people will be able to open the document.
Oh, yeah, not only that, your document is preserved in the cloud, it's safe. I think it's a good way to go.
Okay. And what about, like, security? It's pretty much the same.
It's very similar, not to the desktop, but to other mobile systems. Desktop security is tough because all the desktop operating systems were developed before this was a big issue. So security is an afterthought on Windows, on OS X. But on mobile, I mean, Android and iOS were developed in the hacker era, so they've done more to protect you. And while in theory, I guess you could make the case that Android's more susceptible to malware, I don't find that to be the case in practice.
Right.
I think Google's done a lot to keep it safe. You know, the people who say that say, well, look, Apple makes sure that they check every app before they put it in the App Store. Yeah, well. But when you're checking 10,000 apps a day, lots of stuff gets through. You cannot be perfect on that. So Google doesn't pretend to do that. They say, but if there's a problem, we'll pull it. But to my knowledge, there's never been a massive, significant problem. There, you got to be careful. You can't get, free wallpaper packs from China. Be careful about where you get your software from. But if you get software from known, people and so forth, you'll be fine. I think the Nexus 7 at just a little over 200 bucks, I think $229 is a great deal, a wonderful tablet. Very happy with it.
Yeah. Okay. So
now, having said that, there are inexpensive Windows tablets out there. The Dell Venue Pro is a Windows 8 Pro tablet. Starts at about $230. It's pretty sweet. So you know, the real problem is you have a lot of choices out there. If what you want is to replace a Windows machine, you'd probably, be happier with Windows itself. The problem with XP is, come April, Microsoft has said, we're not going to fix any problems that come up. We're not even major security flaws. You're on your own. And that's bad. That's really bad.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, well, thank you very much.
Yeah, take a look at the Dell Venue. If you want Windows, Dell Venue 8 Windows Pro version, it's $239. That's amazing. And the people I know, we had somebody call yesterday, said, I love this thing. It's not the fastest processor out there, but it'll still be 10 times faster than your XP machine. More than that. Yeah, this is a good time to be buying a computer, I got to say. Thomas in Vancouver, Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Hi, Thomas.
Hello, how's it going?
Oh, it's going well. How are you doing?
I'm doing good. You and I are big rivals, actually, when it comes to football. I'm a Seahawks fan.
Oh, well, it looks like you and I will have a little something-something next weekend.
Totally. Totally
true. And I'm scared to death. I got to say, I watched the Seahawks play yesterday, and they looked awfully good.
You better be. We're number one in defense right now, actually.
Yeah, well, we're number two in defense, so it's not exactly a big difference.
True.
It's going to be great. You know what? I'm very, very excited. But let's not talk football because we're,
No. we're short on time. Yep. I have a question about port forwarding and how secure that is if I was to enable port forwarding. I'm wanting to host a Minecraft server for a small group of my friends, and I just want to know how secure.
So, let me kind of explain what you're doing for the non-techie, the non-geek out there. When you have, nowadays we all have multiple computers, or many of us have multiple computers in a house, and connected to a single internet connection via the router, right? That's your internet sharing device. And so the router means that to the outside world it looks like a single network, but inside you have multiple machines all communicating with one another and the outside world. When you want to have a server, that is, when you want to run something inside your network that the outside world can come and visit, in this case, Minecraft, you're opening up a potential for problems because you're essentially saying people from the outside can come in through that router into your internal network. Now, before that can even happen, you usually have to tell the router, give the router some special instructions because routers are designed to basically ignore incoming traffic. They allow outbound traffic, and then they allow you to establish a conversation. So any packets that come in that they expect, they say, okay. But unexpected packets, like somebody saying, I want to join Thomas's Minecraft server, they just get knocked off. They go, I don't know what you're talking about. Go away. So you tell the router, you say, hey, if anybody wants to play Minecraft with me, send it over to this machine. That's called port forwarding. they come in on a certain port, a port that Minecraft uses, usually more than one. And when any traffic comes in on that port, you've instructed the router, hey, come over here. Now, that limits a little bit of the damage, but you're relying, mostly you're relying on that Minecraft server to be secure. If there's a flaw, and so you, whenever you run a server, one of the responsibilities you have now is to make sure that you always keep that server secure and up to date. And so you got to keep an eye for patches, security exploits, flaws. Because if there's a server that's running in your network and you're letting strangers in to use that server, if one of the strangers happens to know a way he can get around your network via that server, he could infect your network.
Is there some kind of software that can try to prevent that? As I'm
Yeah, well, you should
server?
Certainly run the Windows firewall on all the other machines, because that will kind of isolate those machines from the Minecraft server. So that's for sure. But mostly you've got to keep that Minecraft server secure. That's your biggest job. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Robin in North Hills, California. Hi, Robin. Leo Laporte, the tech guy.
Hi, Leo.
Hey.
Hi. I was in the earthquake in 89. I was on the sixth floor of the science building of San Jose State trying to take a test.
Ah! We were talking because somebody in the chat room said, did you feel that 4.1 in Cloverdale, which is up the road a piece? I said, I don't feel anything less than a 7 after the one in 89. I don't mean to be, because earthquakes can be very, very scary. But no, we didn't. A 4.0 is not very strong.
No, it's not.
But what was it? A 7? It was a 7, wasn't it, in 89? It was a bad one.
Something like that. Yeah. I was also in the Northridge quake in 94. Oh,
that was another bad one. You have bad luck. I'm staying away from you, Robin. Yeah, that I was at Candlestick because it was game 3 of the World Series, the Giants and the Oakland A's. And, of course, the game did not go on, and they put the World Series on hold for a couple of weeks because of that earthquake. Those are the days. What can I do for you?
That was not a fun experience.
No.
We are kicking our cable bill to the curb. Trying to do some cost-cutting measures to lower our monthly expenses.
Love that. Good.
And trying to figure out what we should do. We've been so spoiled by the DVR with, you know, access on every TV to recorded shows. What do we do? What would you suggest to do to record stuff that we want to either save or...
Well, are you going to have an antenna?
We're hoping that antenna is going to work. We're about to get one installed, so hopefully that's going to get us all the channels we want.
Yeah, you're close enough to downtown L.A. to be able to get those, aren't you?
Well, I try a little, you know, sit next to the TV antenna, and I'm not getting CBS at all, and some channels are breaking up pretty bad.
Yeah, so you're going to go to a place called Antenna Web at antennaweb.org, and they... And you can actually enter in your exact location, and they'll help you understand what kind of antenna you need to receive over the air.
I went to either that site or something similar.
There's other ones, yeah.
My address.
Yeah.
It said everything has really good coverage in my area.
Yeah. So what you'll do is, TV's an antenna sitting next to the TV may not be the... Remember the old days when people climbed up on the roof?
Yep.
You may be doing that. Hey, but the good news is over-the-air television is free and better quality than your cable. The high-def over-the-air is less compressed. It's better. So as long as you have a clear view to Mount Wilson or you don't have something big in the way, you should be okay. And if Antenna Web said you're okay, that's just a question of getting the right antenna. And it needs to be a digital antenna. Remember, these are no longer analog signals and so forth and so on.
That's right. Now, what do you recommend for recording shows?
A TiVo.
Yeah.
A TiVo.
So.
TiVo will do it. TiVo.
Uh-huh.
You can buy them online. You could also go to a company down your way called Weak Knees. At weakknees.com. Only one K. WEAKNEES.com. They sell TiVos and upgraded TiVos. And you know what? They're great guys, too. You can call them and say, here's what I need. I need a TiVo for over the air. What would you get? You're really lucky because TiVo is actually better than any cable company's direct DVR, right? Direct TV dish cable company. They're all terrible. However, over the air TiVos are fabulous.
So, you know, you're going to get the best recording capability out there. In fact, once you've used a TiVo, you never again want to use a DVR from the cable company.
And is that, can you copy onto, I know you said DVDs and physical media are dead, but...
Well, they sell one. They sell one called a Humax that has a DVD burner in it. So, you, yeah, you record to a hard drive, and if you want to save it, you can burn it to a DVD. How about that?
Okay, because my kids are occasionally in TV shows that those we want to keep forever and be able to take and show to other people and all that. So.
This is one of the few ways you can still do that.
So
that's good. Now what eventually you'll do is you'll cut the cord completely. You won't even be watching over the air because as time goes by, everybody who creates content will make it available in some form or fashion over the air. I believe even live content, the Academy Awards, the Super Bowl. In fact, this year is the first year all the NFL playoff games and the Super Bowl are being streamed. That means you can get them over the air. So I think in...
The Chromecast comes in, right?
And the Chromecast is great for that, but so are Rokus. Many TVs have these capabilities. Absolutely. You want to connect your TV to the internet.
Well, I'm really upset about what ABC has now done.
Oh, they hate this because, you know, they're terrified. But time is on our side. These content creators want a double dip. They want you to pay. They want advertisers to give them money for the ads. They want the cable companies to give them money for carriage, and they're double dipping. And you know what?
And now they want cut viewers.
Yeah.
I've been using ABC.com for years.
Yeah.
If I miss my general hospital, they will watch it.
Yeah.
You know, that way. And now you have to give them your cable provider information if your cable is part
of
them.
Right.
And they don't. And their app doesn't work on my tablet.
You could go on and on, but we're in an interim period where it's, you know, they've got these entrenched business interests. They don't want to let go. Same thing happened in the music business. It's happening in the publishing business. But the internet changes all, and in the long run, the internet is like water. The drip, drip, drip of the internet will eventually win. In the meantime, it's going to be ugly. There's a big Supreme Court case coming up. The Supreme Court says they're going to hear the Aereo case. Aereo is a company started by Barry Diller that gives people local television over the internet, in effect. You rent an antenna from them, a dime-sized antenna. They're in a few cities already. They're rolling out across the country. The CBS, 20th Century Fox, Walt Disney, and Comcast are suing them. This case will be heard by the Supreme Court. We will watch with great interest because it has very much to do with the future of court. What you're doing is called cord cutting. Now, here's the bad news. You're still going to pay somebody. You understand that, right? I mean, TiVo's $15 a month, Aereo's $12 a month. You're eliminating the cable bill.
You monthly charge for TiVo?
Yeah, because you pay for the guide. You can buy a $200 or $300 year lifetime subscription if you want. So over the air is the only thing that's free. And by the way, the reaction of companies like CBS and Fox to Aereo is FX has already said. Oh, well, that's it. No more broadcast. We're not going to be over the air because we want to charge you. So it's going to be ugly. You have to pay for the content, ultimately. The future of ads.
What are commercials for?
I know. Ad supported. But what happened is these guys got fat and happy on cable fees. They want to double dip. They want both ads, ad revenue and cable fees. And you can't take it away from them. So if Aereo wins in the Supreme Court, and it's unknown, it's really unknown. I think they should win, but I don't know what the Supreme Court's going to say. You got a bunch of old folks on the Supreme Court. I don't even know if they know what cord cutting is. But if Aereo wins, well, what'll happen is CBS, Disney, and all these other channels will just go off the air or over the air stuff. They'll just say, well, we're not going to do that. We're going to require you have a cable contract. But that's a short-term solution. Because you know what the competition is? Piracy. Every show you want to watch, you can steal. I don't encourage that, but that's what they have to face, is that people are going to get it. And so they've really got to make it possible for us to pay for it in a fair way and not tie us into these
you know, untenable situations. I should be able to get everything over the internet. Period. Period. Good luck. You're in the forefront. That can sometimes mean some arrows in the back. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. I love cord cutters. I love people who say, you know what, I'm not going to pay the cable company $100+ a month. I'm not one of them, by the way. I like my football live. I like my HBO and my Showtime, and I pay for it. But I do think we're in a transitional era. There's really no reason why all this stuff shouldn't be on the internet, except that we have entrenched business interests who say over our dead bodies, we dug that cable in 1973 out to your house, and we'll be darned if we're going to let you just buy bits over it. You've got to buy premium programming because we're paying for the copper. But I think, you know, this is all going to change, right? It's all going to change. That was Robin in North Hills. Let's move to George Ann in Upland, California. Hi, George Ann.
Hi there. I am very worried about XP losing its support. Is there a way that I can install Windows 8 over XP?
Well, probably if you bought that machine with XP on it, it's 10 years old, right?
About.
Yeah. It might run Windows 8 okay. It's such an old machine, you probably... This is a big issue. I completely sympathize. Microsoft says that support for Windows XP will end April 8th. Why? People ask. And Microsoft has a whole page saying why. And what does it mean? Well, it means you're not going to get security updates. And what do they... So they say, how do I stay protected? Get a new PC, they say. Or upgrade your current PC. But then they say in the fine print, very few older computers will be able to run Windows 8.1, which is the latest version of Windows. We recommend you download and run the Windows Upgrade Assistant to see if your system meets requirements. It's probably not going to. So, I don't know what to say. You're being obsoleted. It's okay if you don't go online. If you don't want to go online, that computer will be fine.
You kind of
want to go online, don't you?
Yes.
What do you do with it?
Well, it's a small business.
It's
a small business, and I have proposals to email and...
I hate to say it, but you got 10 good years out of that puppy. It's probably time to bite the bullet, spend a few... It's not a lot, a few hundred dollars.
Right.
For a replacement and get a newer PC.
Okay.
They're not going to. They're obsoleting their antivirus. They're obsoleting all of the security patches. They're basically saying if you continue to use XP after April 8th, heaven help you, because we won't.
Mm.
And I would be willing to bet a lot of money that the bad guys have some great stuff they're just holding on to, waiting till April 9th. And then they know it's never going to be fixed. They can release it because Microsoft's not going to respond. If they release it now, there's a chance Microsoft will release a fix before April 9th. So they're holding. They probably have 100 different things they can do to a Windows XP machine, but they're not doing it because April 9th, they let go. And you know, there's more than 100 million Windows XP machines out there. The bad guys are drooling right now.
Yeah.
They're really excited. But this is a business expense. It's something you do for your business.
Right.
I think you owe it to yourself just to get a nice new machine and say, hey, I got 10 years.
Okay.
With any luck, you'll get another 10 years.
Yeah. Thank you.
I'm sorry, Georgianne. I wish I could give you better news. You know, this is hard because we're, you know, it's not unusual to keep a TV 10 years, a car 10 years. My car is 12 years old now. Runs great. I don't want to throw it out. Your computer probably runs great. The hardware isn't worn out. Nevertheless, the software is in effect. I was excoriating Apple for doing the same thing after 3 years with the original iPad. 3 years and out. Come on. 3 years is too short, but 10, you can't really blame Microsoft. It's been a good run. It's been a good run. Now it's time to let it rest. Let it sleep. You might want to look at Windows 7 instead of Windows 8. There are still plenty of places like Dell and elsewhere that you can get Windows 7 machines. It will be much more like the XP. Much more like the XP. Ashley in Northridge is coming up in just a bit. She's looking for, or he's looking for, a computer, a tablet, and a cell in one device. You know, it's funny when you say that because this is, in fact, the 8th anniversary. What is it? 2007 plus 8. 7th, thank you, anniversary. I can't do math. The 7th anniversary of Steve Jobs saying it's an internet device, it's a phone, it's a music player, all in one. We'll revisit on the 7th anniversary of the announcement of the iPhone. We'll revisit Steve's famous announcement in just a second. 2007. Almost exactly 7 years ago, Steve Jobs on the stage of the Moscone Center. I'll never forget this.
Why would we want to run such a sophisticated operating system on a mobile device? Well, because it's got everything we need. It's got multitasking. It's got the best networking. It already
knows
how to power manage. We've been doing this
there'd
on
be an iPhone. We're pretty
years.
Sure that's what the announcement was.
It's got awesome security.
But they kept it so secret. There were no details.
It's got everything from Cocoa and the graphics, and it's got core animation built in, and it's got the audio and video that OS X is famous for. It's got all the stuff we want, and it's built right in to iPhone.
Let me see if I can find the famous moment on this where he says it's a tablet. Let's see if I an internet device. It's a great moment where he does the reveal. I don't know if I can find that. I'll have to look some more. Really was a great salesman, wasn't he? Great marketer, Steve Jobs. Well, Ashley, here we are 7 years later, and Ashley's looking for one device that does it all. Ashley in Northridge, California. Hi, Ashley.
Hi there.
So tell me what you want.
So I want this, okay? I want the portability of a tablet, the size, the portability of a tablet.
Okay.
The functionality and the operating system of a computer.
Okay.
And I want ease of use of a cell phone. I want to be able to talk. I don't want three separate devices.
Oh, so
I
want you want phone devices. Capability, but you need a certain size screen, don't you? Because otherwise you can't do the other stuff.
Right, exactly. And I want to integrate it. I know the technology is out there. I just know it. I think it has to do with marketing and
it is possible to do internet telephony on almost any tablet. So, for instance, I have an iPad and I put a program called Talkatone on there, which works with Google Voice, and then I can make phone calls, I can text, and I have an iPad.
Get it.
You don't like
right,
it.
Right. I don't want to download anything. I don't want to put in a card or anything. I want it all functioning.
We're out of time. I'm going to have to leave this as an exercise for next week. Let's see if we can find it for you. Leo Laporte, the Tech Guy. Have a great Geek Week. Well, that's it for the Tech Guy show for today. I'm Leo Laporte. Thank you so much for joining us. Don't forget, the Tech Guy is just the tip of the iceberg. We do nearly 30 shows now on the Twit Netcast Network, and you'll find them all at twit.tv. We talk about Windows and Windows Weekly, Macintosh and MacBreak Weekly, iPad on iPad Today. You get your daily dose of tech news from Tech News Today and our weekly roundtable show, This Week in Tech. It's all at twit.tv. And I'll be back next time with another great Tech Guy podcast. Thanks for joining me. See you next time.